Welcome, everybody. I am Alan Mindenhall. Welcome. I am Executive Director of the Manuel H. Johnson Center for Political Economy. We're very thankful to have you all here tonight. The Manuel H. Johnson Center at Troy University provides a dynamic and rigorous education program focused on the moral imperatives of free markets and individual liberty. We are here as part of our Free Enterprise Scholars Program, which is a program we have for undergraduate students that teaches future business leaders about the virtues of commerce and the morality of honest profit. We're in our second year of the Free Enterprise Scholars Program, and we are very excited to have 12 of our Free Enterprise Scholars with us here this evening. I want to thank the Bradley Foundation for providing the funding for the Free Enterprise Scholars Program, and in particular, to thank Young America's Foundation for being here this evening and co-hosting this event. Young America's Foundation is the leading pro-freedom youth organization in the country. With more than 60 years of history and campus activism, YAF is committed to ensuring that increasing numbers of students understand and are inspired by the ideas of individual freedom, free enterprise, and limited government. This lecture is part of YAF's Thomas and Marjorie Mairs Advancing Freedom Lecture Series, which is an annual series that seeks to promote the principles of free enterprise among young Americans. In addition to these initiatives, YAF preserves the Reagan Ranch and Reagan Boyhood Home as presidential sites to educate the next generation about the values and legacies of Ronald Reagan. Finally, I want to thank Daphne Posadas, my graduate assistant, for putting in many, many long hours to organize this event and make this event possible. So thank you, Daphne. At this point, I want to introduce one of our Free Enterprise Scholars, Ms. Haley Hoggle, who will in turn introduce our speaker.
Andrew F. Puzder is a speaker, commentator, attorney, and retired chief executive officer. For 17 years, he served as the successful CEO of CKE Restaurants Incorporated, an international corporation which owns popular restaurant chains, Carl's Jr. and Hardee's. Mr. Puzder is a sought-after commentator on economic and political issues in national publications, including The Wall Street Journal, National Review, Fox News Online, and Real Clear Politics. He has also been a regular guest on Fox News, Fox Business, Newsmax, and CNBC. His online videos on economic issues have garnered millions of views. Today, he is one of the most outspoken voices on the dangers of ESG, environmental, social, and governance investing. He has successfully led the efforts of several states to ensure America's largest investment firms respect the interests of average American investors. Mr. Puzder currently serves on the Board of Advisors for Young America's Foundation Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise. And he is a frequent lecturer and author for the organization on economics, business, and public policy. The titles of his lecture include Why Millennials Should Embrace Capitalism and Reject Socialism, The Moral Case for Capitalism, The Threat of Woke Capitalism, and Why ESG is Socialism in Sheep's Clothing. He has also written two popular books. The first is titled Job Creation, How It Really Works and Why Government Doesn't Understand It. The second is titled The Capitalist Comeback, The Trump Boom and the Left's Plot to Stop It. Earlier in his career, Mr. Puzder was a successful commercial trial lawyer in St. Louis. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Andy Puzder.
All right. Thank you, Haley. I know you were nervous about that. Good afternoon, everybody. Good to see everybody here. I understand I'm going to be able to take questions at the end of this if I get through it quickly enough, so I'm going to go as quickly as I can. It's important for me to hear your questions because my wife tells me I have two problems. One problem is that I don't listen to people, and the other problem, I know she said something, I can't remember what the other one was. Anyway, how many of you know what ESG investing is? How many of you would feel comfortable defining it? Haley would. But Haley's been up here speaking already. That's not surprising. Those of you who have heard of it or understand what it is are probably Dr. Mendenhall students, and you're lucky to have him as a professor. But it's not surprising that so few of you know what it is, because you're not supposed to know what it is. You may know that ESG stands for Environmental, Social, and Governance, as Haley just mentioned. You may wonder why anybody would be upset about that. I mean, it sounds so innocuous. How bad could ESG really be? But it's a ruse. It's a ruse designed to conceal the fact that ESG is really a neo-Marxist form of investing, where a group of financial elites invest other people's money and, without their knowledge or consent, wield the power they get from investing those monies to advance a leftist political agenda. Now, I call it neo-Marxist socialism in sheep's clothing, because we need to call it what it is. Elon Musk recently called it communism rebranded. And that's, there we go. There's Elon. He also called it evil incarnate, but, you know, he's kind of a dramatic guy. But he's not wrong. ESG has become a pervasive and negative influence in our economy, our politics, and our lives. ESG guides the decisions for virtually every major asset manager in this country, including massive investment firms like BlackRock, State Street, Vanguard, that you may have heard of. They manage trillions of dollars in other people's money, their clients' money, sitting in personal stock accounts, 401k plans, or pension funds. But few people understand the extent to which ESG has now permeated our lives, because the left is really very good at hiding what it's actually doing. Even what they call themselves keeps changing as people figure out what they actually support. Marxists, communists, socialists, progressive, globalists, they all refer to essentially the same thing: a collectivist mentality that diminishes us as individuals and consolidates power in the hands of a group of elites. They just change the name whenever people figure out what they're actually up to. What I'm hoping you'll see by the end of my talk today is that the phrase environmental, social, and governance, and the acronym ESG, are just the left's latest effort to conceal its collectivist goals behind an innocuous-sounding name. Now, I'd like to say let's start with the definition, but there is no definition. ESG simply includes any political agenda items progressives, as they most commonly call themselves today, want it to include. We do know for certain that ESG goals include, for example, radical environmental policies, such as enforcing Klaus Schwab's and the World Economic Forum's impractical net zero carbon emissions goal, a power grab that would impoverish billions, lead to worldwide suffering and starvation, accomplish little environmentally, all while destroying the global economy, as current events, particularly in Ukraine, continue to demonstrate. That's the E in ESG. The S includes critical race theory human resource training. That is, training employees that they're either victims or oppressors based solely on their race or their sex. Now, why any rational employer would want to teach employees that they're victims or being oppressed by other employees based solely on their race or sex, something they can't even change, makes absolutely no sense to anybody who's run a business. You know, that hardly promotes the teamwork that's essential to the success of any business. Which leads me to the G, or governance part of ESG. The G includes discriminatory as opposed to merit-based hiring, where you hire people or put people on your board of directors based on their race or their sex rather than their merit or their character. Now, that's actually been something I've been fighting my entire career. As you may know, Martin Luther King once said that he looked forward to the day when people would be judged on the content of their character, not the color of their skin. In corporate America today, making decisions based on the color of a person's skin is now the in thing to do. That's just a few of the leftist policies that progressive activists have employed ESG to support. But I want to leave the specific policies aside for a moment, because it's important to understand that ESG is more than an effort to advance specific issues. At its core, ESG is a rejection of our founding principles and our Judeo-Christian values. It undermines our representative democracy, our economic freedom, and our individual liberty. It threatens our democracy because it's a shortcut around the ballot box that massive investment firms use to implement leftist policies that lack popular support. It threatens our economic freedom because they use their massive shareholdings to compel the CEOs of the companies in which they invest to put these leftist policies above their obligation to generate returns or generate profits for the companies that they run. And it threatens our individual liberty because they use our money, maybe your parents' money, but our money to do it. Our 401k plans, our pension plans, our savings. ESG is a tool to empower corporate and government elites to use the American private sector as a means to avoid the inconvenience and the messiness they see in our representative democracy and our free market economy, both of which put decision-making power in the hands of the people, right, in our hands. We get to vote and we get to choose which products we buy. ESG advocates and collectivists generally prefer to have government elites or corporate elites determining the policies that govern our lives, which is why I say ESG is socialism in sheep's clothing. So how did they advance this ESG agenda? Well, they villainize profit as something that promotes greed and creates inequality. They foster the illusion that profit is gained only by crushing other people. If you believe their rhetoric, the profit motive actually threatens the very existence of life on our planet. That's just not true. What they're actually attacking is the notion unique to free market capitalism that you can improve your life, you can profit through your own efforts. President Reagan believed that the ability to profit from your own efforts and freedom were inseparable concepts, and he was correct. It's the profit motive, the fact that everybody has the freedom and the opportunity to better their lives that drives the great engine of our economic productivity. These ESG collectivists know that the profit motive is the heart and soul of free market capitalism. So they target profit as an enemy they must defeat to save humanity. At its core, ESG is an attempt to reorient modern corporations so that rather than focusing on profits, they focus on advancing leftist political goals, which they frame as efforts to save the world. Now, some of you may say, yeah, well, what's so great about capitalism? Isn't it better if corporations pursue these social and political goals rather than profits? I mean, there's too much poverty, there's too much human suffering, there's too much carbon. Won't having businesses pursue ESG goals result in a better world? And the simple answer is no, it won't. Despite what the left claims, and no matter what they call it, communism, socialism, ESG investing, they all represent the forced pursuit of elitist determined social or political goals rather than individual goals. And this always and everywhere results in great affluence for the elites, but poverty, want, and despair for the masses. On the other hand, rather than a source for oppression, the profit motive has proven to be the only effective reducer or the only effective driver of global prosperity. It's moral and its impact is benevolent. Now, that's certainly not what you're going to read in the Huffington Post or the New York Times, but I believe it's an indisputable fact. Well, why do I believe that? Well, in free market economies, businesses only profit by meeting the needs of others. Capitalism encourages people to improve their lives by providing the products or services that other people want at a price they can afford. In this sense, businesses striving for profit benefits society as a whole. That's more altruistic than greedy. When I was the CEO of CKE Restaurants, we spent literally millions of dollars every year trying to determine what consumers wanted. What did you want? What kind of burgers did you want? And how could we offer them at a price you could afford? If we didn't do that, our competitors would, and we'd have been out of business. Under capitalism, knowing what your customers want and offering it at an affordable price is the key to success. In fact, it's the key to survival. Capitalism is a form of economic democracy where consumers vote with every dollar they spend, determining which businesses succeed and which businesses fail. Consumers have the economic power, not government or corporate elites, because it isn't government or corporate elites that decide which businesses succeed or fail. It's consumers. So the power resides with us. The economy responds to us, and therefore we benefit from it rather than the elites. This is a good rule to remember. The benefits in any economy go to those who hold the economic power. Capitalism empowers the common man and the common woman, as businesses need our vote for their success, and they compete for that vote. You know, think about the thousands of products in your local grocery store, shopping mall, or on Amazon, all vying for your attention. You know, at the grocery store, the products are almost jumping off the shelves to try and convince you that they have what you want at a price you can afford. Each of these products represents an entrepreneur striving to meet your needs as the way to achieve their success. Now, that may or may not be purely altruistic conduct. Capitalism depends on the natural desire to improve our lives. I'm not claiming that businessmen are saints. They're not Mother Teresa. But it channels that natural desire to improve your life into focusing on the needs of other people. You improve your life by satisfying other people's needs. It, you know, it's a heck of a motivator. Think about it. Henry Ford, he built cars for the common man and the common woman, not kings, queens, or nobility. Steve Jobs created iPhones or smartphones for all of us, not government or corporate elites. Jeff Bezos became fabulously wealthy because he created the greatest distribution system in the history of the world. Now, none of these individuals became wealthy because they stole from us. Bezos, Jobs, they became tremendously wealthy because they provided us with tremendous benefits. You know, from Bezos to Musk to Jobs to the family that runs your local pizza joint or the local burger joint. In a free market economy, we benefit to the extent we benefit others. As a result, throughout our history as a nation, self-made men and women, free from government interference, have forged ahead with innovative ideas and solutions that created jobs, wealth, and prosperity, not only for themselves, but for the entire nation. They improved their fortunes and, in the process, the lives of their fellow citizens and the human condition. Now, some of you may still ask, yeah, but, you know, does free market capitalism really improve the lives of ordinary people? Or does it just improve the fortunes of the ultra-wealthy, you know, as Bernie Sanders, AOC, and President Biden would have you believe? Well, the simple fact is that the only system in human history that has ever meaningfully reduced poverty is free market capitalism. And I'm going to show you a couple of graphs to make the point. The first graph is based on data from a historical economist named Angus Madison. He's an English economist. He tracked the historic growth of GDP per capita. For those of you who aren't in Dr. Mendenhall's course, that means economic growth per person. You take all the economic growth on the planet, and you divide it by the number of people on the planet, and you have the GDP per capita. And GDP, as you probably know, is the most broadly accepted measure of a country's, and in this case, the world's, economic success. This goes back to the year zero, and it's not hard to tell. So it's 2,000 years old. There's a NYU professor named Jonathan Haidt. He's a very famous professor at their business school. He called it the most important graph in the world. And he's right. With the rise of capitalism around 1820, economic growth per person literally soared. You know, up to 1820, much of the world lived in extreme poverty as a result of every economic system ever tried other than free market capitalism. This surge is the result of countries worldwide adopting free market capitalist economic systems. It's nothing short of an economic miracle, and it's a feat unmatched, as you can see, in human history. Could you imagine running a business and you had a graph like this on your sales? I mean, you know, they'd be crowning you the king of sales. I mean, you can't do better than this. This is talk about a hockey stick graph. And it all happened in the blink of an eye, historically. Now, I showed this chart to a couple of my sons when they were in their 20s, and they wondered whether this was just the result of the Industrial Revolution. They said, yeah, Dad, you're going to tell us this is capitalism, but we know this is the Industrial Revolution. That's really a chicken and egg argument, and it's also just not correct. I actually showed them another chart. This chart breaks down that surge that you see as one straight line in the prior chart, breaks it down by regions. And you can clearly see that capitalism deserves the credit. The first part of the surge occurred in America, just following the adoption of free market capitalism. In fact, in just over 100 years, by 1885, the United States grew from 13 backwoods colonies on the coast of North America to the world's largest economy, even greater than Great Britain in its day. We were the world's largest economy in 1885, and we've been the largest world economy ever since. Europe surged after World War II. You can see Europe is the blue line, where it says Western Europe. I guess it's pretty easy to see. But it started to go up, and then it really jumped up after World War II with the fall of the European monarchies in World War I and II, and the fall of the German National Socialist Workers' Party, or the Nazis, who were clearly socialists. It's right in their name. But Japan is perhaps the most impressive example. Next to the United States, Japan surged following World War II when General MacArthur worked with the Japanese to establish a free market capitalist economy. And almost immediately, for the first time in 2,000 years at least, Japan surged ahead of Western Europe when it came to GDP per capita. Eastern Europe surged with the fall of the Soviet Union. Again, the Union of the Soviet Socialist Republics. Are you noticing a theme here? You know, again, socialist. China surges with the rise of red capitalism. It isn't even real capitalism. And they improve their economy. You can see the lines for Eastern Europe down at the bottom there, and you can see the line for China prior to their adoption of red capitalism, and Eastern Europe prior to the fall of the Soviet Union. And they're extremely low. That's the poverty of socialism. Capitalism works. Socialism does not. Now, some of you may say, okay, wealth surged. All right, I got it. But did the poor really benefit? Well, in fact, they did, and beyond dispute, they did. This next chart takes I could tell you about it, but better if you could see it. Guys, it's not. I'm clicking, and nothing's happening. Forward, backward, up, way down, nothing happens. Any suggestions back there? Any suggestions? There you go. That's too bad. This is the best chart in the whole presentation. All right, well, he's back there working on this. This chart actually puts the wealth creation that I just showed you in context. It takes the Angus Madison data, which is the GDP per capita. That's the blue line. And this goes back to 1820. So you can see back in 1820, it's near GDP per capita is near zero. And it shoots up, as you saw in the original graph. The other line is in red is World Bank data on extreme poverty, going back to 1820. And you can see, although we have two very different data sets. In other words, this data wasn't coordinated. The red is from the World Bank. The blue is from Angus Madison. And as you can see, as GDP per capita increases, people living in extreme poverty decreased. In fact, it dropped like a rock. You know, the point, the poor clearly saw the benefits of the rise in GDP per capita. 90% of people worldwide were living in extreme poverty in 1820. 90%. If you don't believe that, read a Dickens book. If you had regular poverty in, 94% of people were living in poverty. Today, that number is under 10%. It's actually about 8 or 9%. Went up a little during the pandemic, now came back down. This is an incredible feat. And again, happened in the blink of an eye historically, all due to free market capitalism. And you don't have to believe me. Don't take my word for it. Even Barack Obama, President Obama speaking at Georgetown University in 2015, said, "We don't dispute that the free market is the greatest producer of wealth in history. It has lifted billions of people out of poverty." And free market capitalism works because of the incredible economic energy generated by individuals who are free to focus on improving their lives through their personal efforts, that is, the profit motive. The greater the potential for profit, the greater risks people are willing to take, the greater investments people are willing to make, and the greater the associated economic growth, all resulting in broad-based prosperity and the greatest reduction in both human suffering and extreme poverty in human history. Now, to the extent we allow ESG to reorient modern corporations towards accomplishing political or social objectives rather than making a profit, we place the tremendous benefits of this profit-driven model at risk. Now, what sane person would want, why would you want to do that? Why destroy a system that has created unprecedented human prosperity, lifting billions of people out of poverty, as even President Obama acknowledged? Well, the answer is a familiar refrain throughout the history of socialism. Rather than empowering the common man and woman, ESG seeks to empower a class of elites who believe they can manage our lives better than we can. It's not about freedom for the people. It's about exerting power over people and transferring it to collectivist elites, or with ESG financial elites, as former British Prime Minister and Ronald Reagan ally Margaret Thatcher once pointed out. So, how exactly does ESG attack free markets? Well, let's look at BlackRock. There we go. BlackRock is the world's largest asset management firm, and its CEO, Larry Fink, is the poster CEO for ESG investing. BlackRock manages about $10 trillion in other people's money. They are at least a 5% shareholder in 97.5% of the companies in the S&P 500. The S&P 500 is the 500 largest companies in America. BlackRock, through investing other people's money, has at least 5% of each of those companies, almost each of those companies. BlackRock's ownership role is incredible. So when Fink talks, America's CEOs listen. You know, for years, Fink has written an annual letter to America's CEOs telling them what he expects from them in the coming year. Until recently, these letters were laced with ESG-supporting directives, particularly the E in ESG. He is an unabashed advocate and crusader for the most radical environmental policies, such as the World Economic Forum's net zero carbon emissions by 2050. Now, personally, this is just me, I consider net zero a luxury policy that would impoverish the middle class and the working class while further impoverishing, if not starving, the poor worldwide to advance a green agenda only wealthy elites could afford. But it really doesn't matter what I think or what Larry Fink thinks. The real question here is whether Larry Fink should be using the power he gets from investing your parents' money, your money, other people's money, to advance his political beliefs, regardless of who agrees or disagrees with him. In his 2021 letter to America's CEOs, Fink literally stated that all companies must begin to transition to net zero today, which he acknowledged would require a transformation of the entire economy, which of course raised a question. Who appointed you to transform the entire economy? And transform it to what? Apparently, an economy that did what Fink told it to do. How would he personally transform the economy? Well, he wasn't shy about it. In Fink's own words, behaviors are going to have to change, and this is one thing we are asking companies. You have to force behaviors, and at BlackRock, we are forcing behaviors. Now, think about that for a moment. Not American consumers, right, in a free market economy, not American voters in our representative democracy, but Larry Fink, BlackRock, and these financial elites setting policies for the country. With his thumb on BlackRock's incredible proxy voting power, a power derived from the money that Fink invests for other people, again, pension funds, 401ks, savings, Fink believed it was okay for him to simply force the policies or the ideology he supported on our nation without the consent of the governed, let alone his investors, and without regard for the best financial interests of BlackRock's investors. And he wasn't just bragging that he could do this. He was actually doing it. Also in 2021, Exxon, America's largest energy producer, an incredibly successful company tracing its roots back to John D. Rockefeller, was facing a challenge from a minor insurgent shareholder called Engine Number One. They wanted to put environmentalists on Exxon's board of directors. Now, at first, people thought that was a joke. You know, are you going to put environmentalists on Exxon's board of directors? Exxon's management, you know, was focused on profits for the people who invest in Exxon, opposed it. But to ensure that the environmentalist hedge fund's nominees were put on Exxon's board, BlackRock used its massive proxy voting power to support Engine Number One and voted against Exxon's profit-focused management team. Now, BlackRock wasn't alone. Vanguard and State Street, the other two extremely large asset managers, also voted to put these financial managers on Engine Number One's board of directors, these environmentalists on Engine Number One's board. And as a result, the environmentalists now sit on Exxon's board of directors. Now, as absurd as it sounds, within less than a year, Exxon, our nation's largest and most profitable oil company, adopted a net zero carbon by 2050 policy. So America's preeminent oil company adopted a policy severely reducing, if not eliminating, demand for the very product that justifies its existence. Now, that didn't happen, and whether you agree with this net zero or not, this didn't happen because we, the people, or our elected representatives, wanted companies like Exxon to enact such a self-destructive policy. It certainly didn't happen because there was a lack of consumer demand for Exxon's products. To the contrary, demand is accelerating worldwide. And it didn't happen because Exxon's actual beneficial shareholders, the people on whose behalf BlackRock invests, thought this was a good idea or had the best financial interests of the company, because obviously it's not. It happened because a group of ESG-supporting financial elites overrode our representative democracy, overrode our consumer-driven economy, and ignored the profit motive by using the power they derived from investing our money to implement their political and ideological goals. And there you've got ESG in a nutshell. Socialism in sheep's clothing. Does anyone think that destroying demand for Exxon's products is in the best interest of Exxon's investors? The people whose money think is investing? Obviously it's not. This was a purely political move, contrary to the financial interests of the people whose money Fink was investing, people that were just, you know, looking forward to a comfortable retirement. Now, look, if you believe carbon emissions are bad for the environment, support and vote for politicians who share your belief. That's your right. Use the ballot box. But if you're a firm that invests other people's money that they depend on to make ends meet or to get by in retirement, don't invest in a company and then try and destroy demands for its products to pursue your personal political beliefs. Always keep in mind that the economic burden of BlackRock's ESG agenda falls not only on the affluent, it also reduces returns and increases fees for ordinary folk who just want a return on their pension fund or 401k investment so they can enjoy, again, a comfortable retirement. Do Fink's radical environmental policies maximize returns for these investors? Well, of course not. Fink's own 2022 letter to CEOs states plainly, we need to be honest about the fact that green products often come at a higher cost. Well, of course they do. You don't need an accounting degree to know that high-cost, low-return environmental policies will reduce a company's profits. And it's BlackRock's investors who pay the costs in the form of reduced returns on their investments. It's a tax that nobody voted for. In fact, no one should make the mistake of believing that a true ESG investment model is even intended to maximize returns for investors. Tim Buckley is the CEO. Tim Buckley is the CEO of Vanguard, which is BlackRock's largest competitor. Actually, sometimes BlackRock's a little bigger than Vanguard's a little bigger than BlackRock. Sometimes it's not. Depends on whether you measure. But they both manage close to $10 trillion in assets, so close to $20 trillion collectively. And Buckley recently admitted that ESG investing does not produce superior returns for its clients. Now, it's worth noting that Vanguard was an ESG advocate until recently. It actually voted to put environmentalists on Exxon's board along with BlackRock. So Buckley can't go too far in conceding that ESG investing is an economic failure. But in reality, the better studies show that ESG produces diminished returns and higher fees. But do we really need, do you really need a study to show you that investment companies won't maximize profits for their investors if that isn't their objective? If your objectives are political, not financial, your results are going to be political, not financial. Do you need an economist? And this is a point. If you don't walk away with anything else tonight, I hope you walk away with this. Do we really need an economist to tell us that businesses that focus on profits will be more profitable than businesses that don't? In case there's a liberal economist out there or a Keynesian, I'll repeat that. Businesses that focus on profits will be more profitable than businesses that don't. I was the CEO of a large company, and I can tell you, it's hard enough to make a profit when you focus on it, let alone when you're trying to change the world pursuant to some progressive economic agenda. Now, the good news is that people have noticed what happened with Exxon. Exxon was a big deal, and it woke up some red state governors, treasurers, attorney generals, legislators, and activist groups. It was patently obvious that asset managers such as BlackRock were successfully using red state monies to advance a progressive political agenda. So in 2021, red states started passing legislation to resist this ESG juggernaut, making it clear that it's a breach of fiduciary duty to invest other people's money or to vote the shares you hold beneficially on behalf of others to advance your political or ideological objective. 10 states have passed such legislation so far. I actually drafted the original bill that proceeded on this fiduciary duty theory. And now we had about 20% of the country's states just last year passed this bill. States have also been withdrawing funds, pension fund monies from BlackRock because of its ESG investing. To date, they've withdrawn over $4.8 billion. This all has an impact. The momentum is beginning to shift on this issue. In fact, the ESG resistance is now living in Larry Fink's head, and he seems stunned that anybody would challenge his power. Speaking at the Aspen Ideas Festival in June, Fink said that he doesn't even use the word ESG anymore because it's been entirely weaponized. Our business was hurt. We lost $4 billion of mandates. I'm ashamed of being part of this conversation. No, but seriously, this was the guy, this was the lead ESG advocate, right? He was gonna force a transformation of the entire economy. And now even the term ESG kind of creeps him out. He's ashamed. In fairness, if I lost $4 billion, I'd probably be ashamed too. This is great news, and it's a real improvement. But don't be misled into thinking that Fink and his social crusading allies have given up. In fact, while Fink stated that he was embarrassed to use the term ESG, he also said, "I do believe in conscientious capitalism." Oh, yeah, that's not ESG. That's something else. He also floated the term stakeholder capitalism as opposed to ESG. As I said at the beginning, people on the left literally think they can just change the names, advance the same goals, and no one will notice. Hopefully they're wrong. People are now awake rather than woke. Rather than a great reset, which Klaus Schwab has called for, we seem to be experiencing a great awakening where people across the country are saying, wait, I don't want my funds invested for your political motives. I want them invested so that you generate a return for me. It's my money. So make no mistake, this fight's far from over. The collectivist elites will not give up. Why won't they give up, you might ask? Well, in addition to being the beneficiaries of these elitist economic systems, these ESG advocates have convinced themselves, and unfortunately others, that they love mankind and that they're very moral people, even while what they are pushing is devastating for humanity. This attack on profits and free markets is a generational fight, and it's your generation's fight should you choose to take up the mantle. The challenge for my father's generation, he was a combat vet in World War II, but the challenge for his generation was the National Socialist German Workers' Party, as I said earlier, the Nazis. At one point in the 1930s and 40s, it really looked like the Nazis were going to be invincible, right? They weren't. My generation's challenge was communism and the Union of the Soviet Socialist Republics, who at one point seemed to be winning. again, the Socialist Republic. You get a theme here? Thanks to President Reagan, with some help from Margaret Thatcher and Pope John Paul II, the Soviet Union was defeated, and defeated by free market capitalism, I might point out, without a gunshot being fired. But at least the Nazis and the Soviets had the courage to put socialism right in their name. ESG advocates apparently figured out that it's a bad idea to use the word socialism, given its historic failures. So this generation's challenge is socialism in sheep's clothing. As Elon Musk said, communism rebranded. ESG, conscientious capitalism, stakeholder capitalism, all these terms may sound innocuous. They're not. Far from it. They're attempts by corporate and government elites, modern-day collectivists, to co-opt the greatest engine of freedom and prosperity in human history and employ it to implement a leftist political agenda they are otherwise unable to accomplish at the ballot box because the American people simply don't support it. There's a 1977 speech at Hillsdale College by President Reagan, and this kind of explains why, you know, you might wonder, why is this guy here talking to us? Like, what's the motivation to come and make a presentation like this? And this kind of sets it forward, if I can get to it. There we go. No, that's too far back. Okay. Anyway, Reagan stated that we must use the vitality and magic of the marketplace to save our way of life, or we would one day have to explain to our children and grandchildren where we were and what we were doing on the day freedom was lost. You know, as the thought leaders of your generation, if you are to preserve our freedoms and our liberties, you can't rest, you can't waver, you can't retreat. Our freedom will be lost. This is a long-term fight. You're already on the right path. You're attending YAF events, Young America's Foundation events, where the issues are discussed. I think just, even if you don't agree, just hearing the issue discussed, I think, is a very positive thing. You should get others to attend. You know, some take Dr. Mendenhall's course. You know, this is a way you can be exposed to ideas that you may not have heard before. And if you do share these beliefs, speak up when you can, write about free markets, work, support, and vote for candidates who support your beliefs, run for office yourself, and let the collectivists of your era know that the American people, including your generation, are aware of these issues and paying attention to their thinly veiled efforts to suppress our freedoms, our liberty, and our democracy. May God bless each of you, may God bless Troy University, and may God bless the United States of America. Thank you. All right, how are we doing questions? I see Haley has a microphone.
So if you have a question, you can line up right here, and we'll just take questions.
Ah, thank you. I'm just happy I made it through. Like I told you, I had this terrible respiratory infection, and I have asthma, so like it's like a bad thing. And this morning I woke up and said, I don't think I can get through a speech tonight. So I'm just happy that I made it through to the end. All right, questions? Yes.
Hello sir, and thank you for coming to Troy University to speak with us tonight.
Happy to do it.
You spoke about ESG also falling under the name of stakeholder capitalism. Could you expound on that a little bit more?
Well, it's really what they're trying to do now with stakeholder capitalism is use the phrase to do what they were doing with ESG, but they figure the people won't know. Stakeholder capitalism, as advocated by the Business Roundtable, said we're no longer, and this is the kind of thing they do. So this is a good question. I'm glad you asked. What the Business Roundtable, you know, 150 of America's or 180 of America's largest companies came out and said, we're not going to focus on shareholder returns as our primary objective anymore. We're now going to focus on customers, employees, suppliers, and our community. Well, you know, those are the four things you have to focus on to generate returns for investors. I mean, what idiot CEO doesn't focus on customers? I mean, you know, do you ever run a business? You ever see a business that didn't focus on its customers? If you did, you didn't see it for long because it disappeared. And you have to focus on your employees. They are your most important asset. There's nothing more important than your employees. And as for your suppliers, you know what happens if you don't treat your suppliers well? They supply your competitors and give them a better price. You know, during the pandemic, that was a disaster for some companies. And everybody knows you have to be liked during, you know, in your community. If you're not liked in your community, nobody's going to purchase your product or your services. So to say, well, we're going to focus on customers, employees, you know, suppliers in our community, I just say we're focusing on generating returns for investors. And if you notice, there are a lot of studies done after the stakeholder capitalism thing as to whether any corporate conduct change. Zippo. No change. You listen to any of the presentations by the companies that signed on to that statement at the Business Roundtable, and they all talk about what? How much they earned, profits, shareholder returns. Yeah, here's an example. One of the things that they're supposed to focus on is employees, right? Let's take Starbucks and Amazon. Pretty leftist companies, right? Progressive companies. It's okay. That's their customer base. They're good with that. So when their employees decided they wanted to unionize, did Starbucks and Amazon say, you know what? We're stakeholder capitalists. We focus on employees. Go ahead and unionize. Investors, you're going to get a smaller return. Our stock's going to go down. You know, we're going to have to pay people more. But, you know, but it's okay because we're good guys and we're stakeholder capitalists. No, they didn't do that. They fought the unionization like it was, you know, the Battle of the Bulge. I mean, they did everything they could to stop their employees from union. So it's just the stakeholder capitalism as it was framed by the Business Roundtable is, in my view, a complete phony. It's a complete ruse. It doesn't mean anything. What Fink is trying to do with it and what Klaus Schwab is trying to do with it is take what they were doing with ESG and give it a new name. So what the Business Roundtable said really isn't all that pertinent.
Thank you, sir.
That was a long answer. I'll try and do shorter answers now.
Hi. Thanks for your presentation. I thought it was very interesting.
Thank you.
I think one of the reasons why ESG is so popular is because it looks good. Like, you can sell it very well and tell people, like, hey, we care about you, we care about the environment, and so on, so on, so. And capitalism doesn't have that great reputation, especially among young people. So what can we do to, like, promote free market capitalism, like, and sell it and make it look good?
Yeah, that's why I'm here. I mean, this is a question I ask myself. I think that people your age need to hear, even if you don't agree with whatever I said, even if you think the charts I showed you are not true, at least you heard it. At least you heard it. So if you can explain to people that capitalism isn't about greed, capitalism, you know, is really a benevolent system where the only way you succeed is meeting the needs of other people. Nobody can argue with that. I mean, every company's out there trying to meet the needs of all the people, as many people as they possibly can, because the more people's needs you meet, the better you perform as a company. So I think that's hard to deal with. And you could refer to these charts are available if you want them. I'll send you copies. I mean, say, look, here's what capitalism did, here's where it did it, and here's what happened to poverty because of it. You know, socialism has literally failed everywhere it's been tried. How can people I want to calm down. Have you people seen what's happened to Venezuela? Venezuela was the richest country in South America. It sits on an ocean of oil. The people in the country are starving. The government made the grocers sell the products on the grocery shelves for less than they paid for them. Guess what happened to those grocery stores? Right? They're gone. People are eating their pets to survive. This was in the New York Times. People are eating their pets to survive. Could you imagine having to eat your dog or your cat, feed them to your kids so that you could survive? This is a terrible, depressive system. Look, the Soviet Union was no better. Cuba is no better. North Korea is no better. North Korea, everybody's starving. Literally, everybody is starving. Have you seen a picture of Kim Jong-un? Does it look like this guy's missed a meal? This is the way socialism and communism work, and this is what they're trying to impose on you.
Thank you.
Okay, this will be our last question.
Oh, bummer.
So ESG is significant in the United States. Do you see it like getting big in other countries?
ESG?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's worldwide. The World Economic Forum is run by a guy named Klaus Schwab. They put together something, what's it called? They have an alliance of financial asset managers. I'm just talking to you about State Street. I'm using Black. By the way, I don't dislike Larry Fink. I don't know him. And I don't dislike BlackRock, but I use them as an example because they kind of set themselves up to be used as an example, and it's easy to understand. But this alliance of ESG promoting financial managers manages $150 trillion. It's an unfathomable amount of money. Our GDP in the United States, the highest GDP in the world, is about $22 trillion. I mean, this is, you know, the power of these people is amazing, which is why it's great that people have started to wake up. I'd also point out that BlackRock, and I haven't looked into this, but BlackRock just announced its first reduction in assets under management, I think, ever. So these things are having an effect, but we can't let them get away with this. You have to understand what you're fighting. My whole thing here really isn't, you know, hate ESG. What I'm saying here is love your freedom. Love our republic and our representative democracy. Love our economic freedom and, as consumers, our ability to drive the economy. Hate it when people try and take away your power. Because when these elitists, when these collectivists take power, they take it from someplace and somebody. And that somebody is you. So remember I said early on, the message here is that I didn't want to focus on particular ESG issues because there's a list of them. But I wanted to focus on what ESG really was all about. And so hopefully that was achieved. But yes, it's worldwide. Mm-hmm. But if the United States changes, it'll change everything. Our biggest opponent in this is Europe. And Europe is actually starting to come around. You probably heard that they're making changes now. Now nuclear power and natural gas are okay. Like a couple years ago, they weren't okay. Then people turned on the lights in Germany and they didn't come on. And they turned on the heat and it didn't come on. And all of a sudden, they realized they needed actual energy, not sunshine, wind, and rainbows. They needed stuff that actually worked. So anyway, is that it? That's the last question?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Thanks, everybody. It's a pleasure being here, and I wish you all the best.